watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Good morning and welcome to Health Science 395, health education resources and strategies that can be used in a variety of settings with children and adolescents. So welcome to the seventh session. This marks our halfway point in the semester. And we've covered a lot of information to date. We've talked a lot about the need for health education, effective health education, strategies to change behavior as kind of our foundation. And then now we're going through the various content areas that have been identified in the content standards for health education as a way to think about some of the different curricular resources that are available to any of us to use with our children and teens in whatever setting we find ourselves in. So I hope that you're starting to see some of the commonalities between some of the resources that are available as they do show some effectiveness. I hope as we go through the various curricula that I highlight each week, you're thinking about how you might use some of these in the settings in which you find yourself. So let's just start off again, just kind of as a way to get grounded in what it is we are doing in health education and think about these health education content standards. Remember, we spent some time on them identifying the eight standards and really how there is a balance between those eight. We have the content that students should know on one side, and then we have all of those skills, what students should be able to do with that content in changing their behaviors. And it really is a balance. We must teach content so that they have accurate current information, but we cannot teach that all by itself. We have to talk about some of the skills, analyzing internal and external influences, how to access valid information, how to make a healthy decision, how to set a healthy goal, how to have positive interpersonal communication with others that is health enhancing. How to actually engage in healthy behaviors. What does that mean? Everything from learning how to wash your hands to how to prepare a nutritious meal. And then if we can get our children and adolescents up to that point, where they are engaging in healthy behavior, then we hope that we can get them to promote health in others, taking what they've learned and what they are doing and encouraging others to learn more and to become healthier individuals. So that's what it is all about when we are thinking about this health education in a community setting, in a school setting, or in a clinical setting. What varies between all of those is the time that we have with our learners, the intensity in which you actually can use some of the curricular resources, or are you just giving those little tidbits, taking advantage of those teachable moments to highlight some of the health content and skills. All of that will be variations depending on where you find yourself. So today we're going to focus on nutrition and physical activity again, more with a focus on physical activity. Since last week we talked about nutrition for our time together. So I'd really like you to think about, this is the same question that I posted last week, about what nutrition and physical activity topics and skills do you think are important to address? And I do hope as you are responding to that question in your mind, if you want to give me a call and let me know what you're thinking, you can certainly do so. There's our 800 number. You can email me and let me know what you think as far as what is it that's important to address with our children and teens. And I do hope that as you are formulating your response, you are reflecting on the health education content standards. This is what the state of California Board of Education has identified as kind of the foundation, the basic information that students should know and be able to do. And you should all be fairly familiar with the setup of the content standards. We're using this as a way to think about all of the different content areas in health education. It helps us identify what is age appropriate for the population with which we work. If you're working in a school, it's easy because the grade levels are indicated there. But if you're working in a community-based organization or an after-school program or even in a clinical setting, you think, well, what is it that's age appropriate? Well, the standards give us a great deal of indication into that. So I hope that you've read these several times. And I do hope that as you are reading them, you're going, yes, kindergarten students do need to know this. They need to be able to do these things. Oh yeah, here's something for fourth or fifth graders. You know, that seems to be right on target with what I'm seeing in the work that I do with that age group or middle or high school students. So we want to use this as a foundation for what is critical that students should know and be able to do. And obviously, I'm hoping that each of you is finding the textbook helpful. What do teachers need to know? And when I ask that question, teachers is a generic term, as you would. I mean, yes, this textbook is written for those who will be classroom teachers. But remember, any of you who are sharing information with others and encouraging them to take up these healthy lifestyles are, in essence, a teacher. And it's critical that teachers have the background information that will help them get their points across to the learners or the students. So I hope you are finding that the reading maybe reinforces some of the concepts you already know. It may dig deeper into them and provide you with additional information. And for those of us who may have misperceptions about some of the content, this will help us clarify some of those misperceptions and correct them. So I do hope that you are reading through the text and really looking at it through the lens of this is what a teacher or an instructor or a clinician or a community health worker need to know as they provide health education to children and teens. And then, of course, the standards provide us with what students should know and do. So I hope that these resources, just in those two documents, really help you identify what nutrition and physical activity topics are important to students that you address. I hope that also each of you, because I know those of you who are enrolled in this class come from quite different backgrounds. Some of you, I think, are pre-physical therapy majors. Some of you are community health. Some of you may be early childhood or school age. You're working on your teaching credential. I do hope that you are finding all of this helpful, and that as we go through the variety of curricular resources that are available, you're finding things that are available to you that can be adapted into your setting. So let's start again with the state of the art. Remember, in all that we do, we want to avoid reinventing the wheel. You know, if we know of documents, of studies out there that have really laid the foundation on what is important, that we utilize those. We go beyond what we think is important to looking at some of these documents as primary sources of information. And I know that last week I identified for each of you the school health guidelines to promote healthy eating and physical activity. That was a Center for Disease Control document. We gave you the website for that. It's posted on Blackboard for you to review. And really, when we talk about state of the art, this is state of the art because it's not only looking at what the student, the learner, should know and be able to do, but what we should be doing in schools to provide a setting that is healthy and encourages those adoptions of health behavior. And if you're not in a school setting, I hope that you'll read that and think about this could also be translated into the physical therapy clinic where I work, or the sports club where I am, or the group of kids that I'm coaching in the soccer league. Wherever you are, I hope you'll kind of think about that in a broader sense. Remember last week that we also talked about the Dietary Guidelines for Americans. Our most current edition is dated 2010. Those are under review, and a revised model may be coming out soon. Remember, those Dietary Guidelines for Americans really form the basis of what we know in nutrition science. And so you need to access those documents, those websites, to really make sure that what you are saying to those that you work with is current and accurate. Nutrition is one of those content areas where many of us feel we have some expertise because we all eat, right? But remember, we want to make sure that we are not providing misinformation to our students. So if you've heard that this supplement or this dietary plan will help students, you know, run faster, jump higher, bulk up, whatever, really make sure that you judge it against the science of nutrition. And if it doesn't measure up, that you're not promoting it. So take some time to review that as you talk about nutrition and physical activity. And then lastly, I want to refer all of you back to the Centers for Disease Control Health Education Curriculum Analysis Tool, the HECAT. Again, I've posted it for you, but all of this is online, and if we go to my desktop, this is something you see me pull up every week, but what you want to do is to judge any curricula that you are considering using with your population, with children and adolescents, judge it against the HECAT. Use this tool to help you evaluate that curriculum. Remember, for those of you who are enrolled in the class, you'll be evaluating a curricula, and submitting that by next Monday. And certainly the HECAT is a document that is available to help you do just that. Remember, you're going to go to the modules component down at the bottom of that page and either go to healthy eating or physical activity. I'll click on physical activity here and take a look at what's in this module. You know, it is focused on behavior outcomes. Remember, that's one of the characteristics of effective health education curricula. And it is aligned to the National Health Education Standards. So you literally can go down, take a look at the curricula that you want to evaluate, and check off each and every one of these points that is addressed in your curricula. Then you can score it, and then you go on to the other standards. Remember, this is broken down by age groups. So this first page is pre-kindergarten through second grade. This is third through fifth, sixth through eight, and nine through 12. So take your curricula and its intended audience, judge it against content standard one, or the knowledge, what should students know, and give it a score. If it's scoring at a four or a three, where it's getting all or most of the knowledge expectations, you've got a pretty good curricula there. If it's scoring at a one or a two, it may be a very good curricula, but you may have to supplement with other resources. It's not all inclusive into that knowledge. And then, of course, you'll continue and use that same module for standards 2 through 8 in looking at, does it meet the expectations for each of those skills? So I hope that you are also becoming very familiar with the HECAT as well. And then, of course, you know, as I have done in the past, I want to encourage you to go to the end of each chapter and take a look at some of the strategies for learning and assessment that are found at the end of each chapter. Take a look, because they too are divided by content standard and by age group, and see if you get some ideas. Again, effective strategies for having students learn the particular content. In this one, I'm looking at the physical activity ones. And how do you assess their learning? If we are teaching students a concept, we need to assess whether or not they learned what we tried to teach them. And if they didn't learn it, we need to try and teach them in a different way, with using different examples or different strategies. And then for those of you who are working with young children, don't forget that at the very end of the chapter, after the strategies for learning and assessment, you will find a list of children's literature, children's storybooks that address the content. If you are working in a community-based organization or a clinical setting, take a look at these titles. See if some of them are in your waiting room, in your library resources that kids, that adults can pick up and can take a look at. You know, it's informal learning, but it can be very powerful. For those of you who are working in child care centers or you're working with families, these might be some great books to either pick up and purchase at a local bookstore or check out from your local library as a way to start conversation around the various health topics. Okay, and then again for nutrition and physical activity, remember, last week we highlighted three curricula I want to reinforce that you take a look at least two of those. I certainly want you to look at choosemyplate.gov. That is the new icon. Actually, it came out in, 2010-11. And, you know, we still have a lot of folks who aren't familiar with it. So use that as a way to teach good nutrition. Remember, there were a lot of resources available at the Dairy Council of California. By age group, and whether you're in an after-school setting or in a classroom setting, the Dairy Council of California has a great deal of resources. In addition, if you're working with adults, they've got some excellent resources on their website as well. So if you want more information on either one of those, you can watch last week's broadcast again, and you can go to the page on Blackboard and visit my links there as well. Okay, so let's get started on looking at some curricula. Again, these are ideas that you can use for your assignment that is due next week. Part of it is that I'm giving you a lot to give you a sense of what's out there. You don't have to review any of the curricula that I share with you if you've got something else that you would like to take through that review process. But here are some ideas in case there's something you want to look at. So the first I want to share with you today is called CATCH. And CATCH is a curricula. It is available for purchase. This is not free. But this is an excellent resource for a school program, for a community program that really has some great components to it, and a curriculum that's evaluated as effective. So there is the website, catchinfo.org, if you would like to take a look more closely at this one. But this is, CATCH is an acronym that stands for Coordinated Approach to Child Health, and really looking at preventing childhood obesity in an environment that is fun and easy to sustain. So really looking at nutrition and physical activity. So as you go through, again, you'll find lots of information. This is a little bit different from the Dairy Council or the Choose My Plate curricula, as it really does become a little bit more comprehensive. Certainly has a lot of resources for physical education and activity. Great connections for family and community, as well as the cafeteria and the classroom. So again, as I've taken you through some of the other curricula, I just want you to see what's here, depending on the age group that you are working with. So pre-K, K-5, 6, 8, and after school. So this one is more for the younger child, the young teens, the elementary kids, as opposed to high school. But again, you'll see impacting knowledge and behavior. Those are things that you're going to want to look for. In the 6-8, supporting healthy lifestyles. So again, behavior-focused curricula. Knowing that lots of our students are in after-school activities, this one is designed for those non-classroom kinds of settings. Here they do have case studies of school districts that have been using the curricula and their results. Again, when you evaluate a website, it's important to see who some of the partners are. And so as you look at the partners, you get a sense of, is this purely promoted by corporate organizations who are trying to sell something, or in fact, you know, is there some type of current medical accurate information? So certainly take a look at each of these. What I'd like to do is just show you that if you are in a place where they are considering spending some funds on some curriculum materials, these programs certainly come with training and support, which is vital in any curricula and has an evidence base. The Catch 6-8 program has proven to increase physical activity, increase healthy food consumption, reduce television viewing, and improve performance on standardized academic achievement tests. So you will see a catalog that you can access for the materials and the equipment necessary. They have a YouTube page so you can actually see it in action, and you can view an example of one of their lesson plans. So if this is of interest to you, I hope you'll spend some time with Catch. Here's another curricula. I know several of you are really focused and interested in physical activity, so I hope I'm gathering some that might really connect with you this week. This is called Spark, and again, this is a commercially prepared curricula. So again, this is one where it does require a source of funding to implement. But again, you will see classroom activity and recess components, an after-school component, and for those of you who are working in early childhood, here's an early childhood component as well. They have lesson plans, webinars. There are tips from their trainers on the implementation. And if you're in an organization where you may not have the funds available for it right now, they also have on here a grant finder, which may help you identify some sources of funding of monies for your program. So again, you want to take a look at the whole website. Frequently asked questions will provide you with a lot of information. But let's just take a look. Let's focus here on the early childhood component. What is it that you can learn from their website? They have a video clip about what's happening in early childhood in Memphis, in New York City, and then their curricular component, their program components. When I talk about program, they have a curricula or the lesson plans. They have training, and then they have equipment that you will actually need to implement a lot of the lessons. This is a fully developed manual. A music CD is enclosed, and there is a family-based website. So lots of resources here that you may want to access. So again, a couple of curricula that are really much more focused on the physical activity part. Okay, so now let's go to the American Heart Association. Now, many of us think about the American Heart Association when we think about heart attacks, right? Heart health, CPR. But the American Heart Association involved in the research around treating heart disease are very committed to promoting the prevention of heart disease. So I wanted to highlight for you some of the resources on the American Heart Association's website, and that is heart.org. And when you go to this site, as I've mentioned in several of the other broadcasts, right there is the educator page. So for those of us who are doing some type of health education in some type of setting, this is where you want to go. If you are classroom focused, there is a section for you. If you are in a physical education or an athletics type of environment, they have some things tailored for you as well. So let's just check out what's in the classroom component. Again, this is a great resource if you want to test your skills at evaluating a curricula and taking a look at some of those characteristics of effective curricula. Elementary school lesson plans, middle school lesson plans. So again, those of you working with older adults, you can certainly take the middle school lesson plans, take the content standards for the high school, and see how closely they might be aligned. But here, you actually can download lesson plans. And there are dozens of lesson plans to download. So every year, they come out with more. There are lesson plans connected to language arts, math, physical education, science, and social studies. At middle school level, art, music, and drama, child development and decision making, health and science. So just numerous resources. There typically is no need to develop your own curricula because they've got some great stuff here. So I certainly encourage you to take a look at all of this. Those of you who've been in schools several years may recognize when you hear that or see the term heart power. That is the Heart Association's curricula. And in the early days, they actually printed off all of the materials and provided them to schools in a kit where teachers could use them. Of course, now in the day of electronics, we can access them here. So certainly I want you to see some of that as well. All right, and here's another Healthy Heart program. This is Healthy Hearts, and the website here, and my apologies, I've got up there on the screen healthyheartsprogram.com. Let's just remember to take out that S. It is healthyheartprogram.com. That was my mistake. So when you go to this website, you will again, oh, and look how fast she did that. Thank you, guys. Healthyheartprogram.com will end you up on a page like this. And this is a great resource for us as well, because in addition to a variety of free lesson plans that you can download, they also include ideas and guidelines on healthy foods in your setting, whether that's a school, community-based organization, or clinic, healthy fundraising, and healthy meeting ideas. And it says for schools, but these are good for all of us. And so if that's something that you may have a passion for, is making your place of work a little bit more heart-friendly or healthy heart, take a look here and see what it is you can find. Again, when you're looking at lesson plans, you're going to be looking at a lot of the school-type activities. Let's go back to the home. Here we go. And look at these lesson plans. By grade level, from kindergarten through sixth grade. Now, obviously, why are so many organizations focusing on that young child? Because typically, we see these young kids in schools, in after-school programs. We can provide them a great deal of prevention education. By the time we're dealing with adults and heart health, typically where we're seeing them in is in a clinical setting where we're trying to help them deal with a heart problem and rectify some of the behaviors that they may have been engaging in. So that's why you see so much focused here. But again, please know that you can take these sixth grade lessons and you may be able to draw something from that to deal with students that you may be working with who are above sixth grade. So don't discount a program just because it doesn't have exactly the grade level you want. All right. Oh, dear. Sorry. I just lost the mouse. Okay. So now let's look at some more physical activity programs. We'll move away from the heart health focus. Let's move. Let's Move is a federal initiative. It came out shortly after the revised Dietary Guidelines for Americans, and it really is about getting folks up and moving. So very often you may be hearing about the Let's Move initiative on television in conjunction with the White House and Michelle Obama. So let's take a look at this website as well. Again, another resource, not so much a full-blown curricula, but here's where you can learn about the Let's Move initiative. Food and nutrition is part of it, obviously, and then getting active, which is the real focus of Let's Move. And then taking action, doing something to promote physical activity in your community. So let's just take a look at the Get Active. The thing I like about this particular initiative is it focuses on active families, active schools, active communities. Looking at Let's Move outside, getting folks out into open areas to become more physically active. So certainly if you are in an environment, a setting where you are working with families, you know, there's some resources here specifically for you. If you are working with your local community governments, your cities, to promote physical activity, here's some as well. So again, a lot of good stuff here. And you will see that there's a place to indicate your own involvement as we look at cities across the country that are involved in the Let's Move campaign. Partnership for Healthy America is a resource that they link to, as well as preventobesity.net. So for those of you who are interested in this particular content area, some great links to other resources. And I think that's what you'll find as you look at several of the sites that I'm sharing, that they're going to link to other resources. So you can continue to get additional information. All right. Another one I'd like to show you about, and it's highlighted in the Let's Move campaign, is the NFL program called NFL Play 60. And NFL Play 60, whoops, I just lost it, sorry. Let me go back on. NFL.com Play 60. Go there and you will actually end up, it now forwards you to nflrush.com, Play 60. And this is an initiative out of the National Football League, again, to encourage kids to be active at least 60 minutes a day to reverse the trend of childhood obesity. What I like here is there's a kids zone. This is very kid-friendly, a lot of activities, a lot of visuals that focus a child's attention with a lot of focus on providing healthy role models. So some of the football players involved in this. If you don't want to go to the kids zone, you can certainly go to the adult area. And here you will find lots of video clips of football players encouraging physical activity. There is the Play 60 Challenge. This is a 4 to 6 week program to encourage us how to be more active and healthy. When you actually go to this, you will find teacher training materials, a teacher's guide, an online tracker to monitor your minutes of physical activity, and then additional teacher resources to keep kids active all year. This is a partnership between the NFL and schools. So they're trying to provide a number of resources for classrooms. Okay, so I encourage you to check out that as well. I'm trying to highlight a variety of curricular resources so that you can see the expanse of those that are available to you. All right, so say we've got a community, a school, a grade level, a group of students that may not be highly motivated by some of the football players. Well, there are others as well. You can certainly find activity promotion in soccer leagues, in baseball, etc. But what if you're not into organized sports? Then I would suggest you take a look at something like the walkbiketoschool.org website. So that's our next resource to take a look at. So when you go to this page, and if we could put up that website, walkbiketoschool.org, you will come to this webpage. And Walk to School Day has been an international event for many years. This month, it was just this week, October 7th. Some schools do a Walk to School Week. Some highlight it the entire month of October, where they are planning events on their school campuses to really encourage walking or biking to school. We know that in many communities, children are riding buses to school just because of transportation, because of the geography, because of the location of schools. So they even have identified ways to walk and bike while you're at school, so that if you are riding the bus to school, you can still be involved in these kind of activities. So here's background information on why walking or biking is important, some ways to participate in the activities. And really, this becomes kind of a community activity in creating it more as an event than a curriculum per se. You can register so that you are kept up to date. And then really, here's the part that I wanted to highlight for you, is walking and biking year-round. So a highlight on pedestrian safety, on bicycle safety, because if we are going to encourage kids to walk and bike to school, while we are encouraging that physical activity, we also want to make sure that we do so in a safe manner. So again, some great resources here. And then the last curricula I want to highlight for you is going back to the Heart Association. You've seen this website before, heart.org. And I want you to look again at the classroom. Whoops, sorry. Let's go back to the screen. There we go. When you're at heart.org, for the classroom, when you scroll through this, there are the elementary lessons. I already shared with you about that. But I'd like you to look closely at this one, Register for School Garden Lesson Plans. School gardens have become another way of promoting physical activity on schools, and then community gardens promoting that physical activity in communities. Most of us don't think about gardening as a physical activity until you actually get in there and start gardening. When you're preparing the garden, when you're planting the seeds, when you are maintaining it, and then when you are eating the fruits of your labor, it's a great way to reinforce the physical activity and the nutrition guidelines. In this curriculum, there are 35 lesson plans to engage students in fun and educational activities around nutrition. This one is geared to preschool through fifth grade, though again, can be easily adapted to some of the older students. All you have to do is to register to get your free copy of the guide. Basically, this is a way that the Heart Association can track who is interested in the guide and who would like to be supported in their implementation. So you can click down here to receive monthly e-newsletters, or you can say, no thanks, don't contact me, basically just send me the guide. But a lot of great resources for gardeners. I think it's important that as we promote physical activity, that we recognize that not all students, teens, adults, families, or communities are focused on sports or in organized athletic events. That we have to provide ways to encourage that healthy eating and physical activity message through non-organized activities as well. And right now, in today's environment, gardening is becoming very a very interesting, very focused area. And we can grow a garden everywhere. You don't need a plot of land. You can grow a garden in containers in your windowsill. You can create window boxes, or you can do the whole blown garden in the ground. But along with the gardening resources, again, the Heart Association wants to get out messages about heart rate, about recognizing signs of heart disease, about emergency procedures for those who may have heart problems, including CPR. And I certainly want to encourage all of you that if you are not certified in CPR, that you think about that as you read through some of the Heart Association's information. Know that on the Heart Association's page, in addition to their curricula, in addition to their resources for gardening, they have a lot of information around events. And you know, health education through events can also be very effective. Again, we want to keep remembering that it's behavior focused, that it's providing accurate current information, that we are focused on developing skills in addition to enhancing an individual's knowledge. And those can be done through events as well. So the Heart Association is famous for its Go Red for Women, which highlights heart disease in women, and that's in February. They also have a program geared toward the Hispanic community. They have programs looking at stroke prevention. And then for those of you who are interested in physical activity programs, they have the Jump Rope for Heart and the Hoops for Heart fundraisers for the American Heart Association, and it also benefits your school. But you'll actually see resources here: jump roping skills, basketball skills, lots of activities and games that you can be involved in. So again, when you go on some of these websites, while I may be focusing your attention to the educator section or to lesson plans or to curricula or programs, please, I hope you will all take advantage of looking at all of the tabs on a website and just taking a look at what's available. Remember, in addition to completing your review of curricula, and you'll do two of those in this class, you're also going to review websites because I think it's important for all of us to gain some experience and expertise on evaluating a website to determine, is the information current and accurate? Is it relevant for my needs, what I want to use it for? Does it come from a source of authority? Is the website user-friendly? All of that. Remember, you're going to go back and use the CRAAP test, and you can access some content in the textbook for evaluating electronic resources. So certainly, I hope that I'm giving you some ideas for not only your curricular review, but for your website review as well. But again, please note that you do not have to use any of the websites or curricula that I provide to you for your assignments. If you have something else you'd like to take a look at and review, that is certainly your choice. All right, so what I'd like to do in our last few minutes, because these are some pretty big assignments that I am asking you to complete, I want to just highlight again some of the requirements of the assignments that are due for you on Monday by 11:59 p.m. As usual, you'll have a journal where it's basically your chance to reflect on what you're learning about the content and the skills, what teachers should know and what students should know and be able to do. But then you're also able to take a look at one of the resources that I've highlighted in the program, in the broadcast, and just take a look at it a little bit more closely. So I know, you know, you're seeing me in a broadcast go to the web page. I want you to actually go to one of the web pages and take a look and see and give me your thoughts as you review that. Just pick one and reflect on that in your journal. But this week, in addition to your journal, you actually do have your first review of health curricula due. It's also due Monday by 11:59 p.m. Remember, you can select any curricula from personal community health, mental, emotional, social health, or nutrition and physical activity to review. So that's anything from our last four broadcasts. What you will do is you're going to take one of those curricula and you're going to spend time looking at the website, looking at the lesson plans, and you're going to provide me a summary of that curricula. You'll provide the name of the curricula resource and the URL address of the site where you've accessed it from, a brief description of the resources available. And what you want to do is, in that brief description, also talk about how does the curricula, how do the lessons align to the content standards or to the HECAT. You can use either of those. And how does it work for the intended audience? So if you're reviewing something that's developed for pre-kindergarten students, how would that work with the intended audience? And if you're thinking about using it with another age group, how do you think it would work? So that's the second part of your review. The third part is a statement of the validity of the information provided in the curricula. So basically, how do you know that this curricula is valid? How do you know the content is current and accurate? The next part of your review is going to be a statement of the evaluation of the social content of the curricula. How do you know it aligns with the standards for evaluation of social content? Remember, that's the document I highlighted, I think, back in broadcast number 3, and it is posted on Blackboard for you as well. And then the last section of your review is a brief description of how you might use the curricula with your chosen specific age group of children or teens in the setting that you find yourself. So this is your chance to say, well, this curricula may be developed for schools, but I'm working in a community-based organization, and I think I could take this and this and this and these activities with my students because. And then just kind of elaborate. So you are going to access the modules for whatever the curricula that it is you've selected: personal, community, health, mental, emotional, social, or nutrition, physical activity. And be sure to use module 3 for the content standards, HECAT, and social review criteria. I anticipate that each of your posts is going to be about 3 to 5 pages in a Word document. Post that as an attachment to the discussion board, and then you have a chance to review each other's posting and make some replies to your peers. So you need to do all of that by Monday evening. So I hope you've actually been preparing for that so that you're not doing it last minute. This will take you a couple, 3 hours to do. Okay, so that brings us to the end of our time today. Please remember all your due dates and deadlines, and meet me back here next week, same time, same place, where we will go on to the next content area and some more ideas for curricula that you can use to encourage others to be healthy. If you have any questions over the course of the weekend, please email me. I will be checking email. I will be responding so that I don't leave you in the lurch until Monday morning. But I am here to help you with your assignments if you have any questions. So until next Saturday, here is wishing each of you health, peace, and happiness. I will see you here next week. Take care.